And the text for our first song that I chose from the lesson is the memory verse, 2 Corinthians 10, 4 and 5. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Under Christian warfare, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty. 6:14, sound the battle cry. Sound the battle cry, see the foe is nigh, raise the standard high for the Lord. Gird your armor on, stand firm everyone, rest your cause upon his holy word. Rouse then, soldiers, rally round the banner, ready, steady, pass the word along. Onward, forward, shout aloud, Hosanna, Christ is captain of the mighty throng. Strong to meet the foe, marching on we go, while our cause we know must prevail. Shield and banner bright, gleaming in the light, battling for the right we ne'er can fail. Rouse and soldiers, rally round the banner, ready, steady, pass the word along. Onward, forward, shout aloud, Hosanna, Christ is captain of the mighty throng. Oh, thou God of all, hear us when we call, help us one and all by thy grace. When the battle's won and the victory won, may we wear the crown before thy face. Rouse then, soldiers, rally round the banner, ready, steady, pass the word along. Onward, forward, shout aloud, Hosanna, Christ is captain of the mighty throng. Okay, for our second song, the text I chose comes from Sunday's lesson. The title of the lesson is The Transformed Life, and the text is John 21:15. And Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than these?" And he said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Feed my sheep." Hymn number 285, under invitation, Jesus calls us. 285. Jesus calls us. Jesus told Peter, "Feed my sheep." 285. Jesus calls us o'er the tumult of our lives while restless sea. Day by day his sweet voice soundeth, saying, "Christian, follow me." Jesus calls us from the worship of the vain world's golden store, from each idol that would keep us, saying, "Christian, love me more." In our joys and in our sorrows, days of toil, calls us by thy mercies, Savior, may we hear thy call, give our hearts to thy obedience, Our third song I've chosen from Monday's lesson. The title of Monday's lesson is The High Cost of Obedience. And the text from Monday's lesson is Acts 7:55. But he, being full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Under glory and praise, hymn number 240. Fairest Lord Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing there. Hymn number 240. Fairest Lord Jesus, ruler of all nature, O Thou of God and man the Son, Thee will I cherish, Thee will I honor, Thou art my glory, joy on the crown. Fair are the meadows, fairer still the woodlands, robed in the blooming garb of spring. Jesus is fairer, Jesus is purer, who makes the woeful heart to sing. Fair is the sunshine, fairer still the moonlight, and all the twinkling starry host. Jesus shines brighter, Jesus shines purer than all the angels heaven can boast. Beautiful Savior, Lord of the nation, Son of God and Son of Man, glory and honor, praise and adoration, now and forever, for be thine. Our fourth song I take from Thursday's lesson. The title of the lesson is Spirit. I have down Spirit, lead obedience. And I don't know whether I've typed that right or not. Anyway, Philippians 2:8 from Thursday's lesson. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Again, under invitation, hymn number 281, I gave my life for thee. Became obedient even to the point of death, the death on the cross. 281, I gave my life for thee. I gave my life for thee. My precious blood I shed, that thou might ransom me and quicken from the dead. I gave my life for thee. What hast thou given for me? I gave my life for thee. What hast thou given for me? My Father's house of light, my glory circles round. I left for I left what have thou art for me? I lift it all for thee, as thou left aught for me. I suffered much for thee, more than thy tongue can tell. O bitterest agony, to rescue thee from hell. I've borne it all for thee. What hast thou borne for me? I've borne it all for thee. What hast thou borne for me? And now for opening song, let us turn to hymn 570, Under Humility, Not I But Christ. 570, Not I But Christ. Let us stand together while we sing this.
Not I but Christ, be honored, loved, exalted. Not I but Christ, be seen, be known, be heard. Not I but Christ, in every look and action. Not I but Christ, in every thought and word. Not I but Christ, be gently soothing sorrow. Not I but Christ, to wipe the falling tear. Not I but Christ, to lift the weary burden. Not I but Christ, to hush away all fear. Christ only, Christ, no idle words are falling. Christ only, Christ, no needless bustling sound. Christ only, Christ, no self-important bearing. Christ only, Christ, no trace of I be found. Not I but Christ, my every need supplying. Not I but Christ, my strength and help to be. Christ only, Christ, my body, soul, and spirit. Christ only, Christ, here and eternally.
Be seated, and thank you much, and thank both of you, and you, Drew, for the long trip.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath to you all. I don't know how this month has got here so quick. I was last up here in February, and all of a sudden it's August. Welcome, all visitors. We almost didn't make it this morning. Coming through Bonita, my prize car was acting up, and we managed, praise God, for to get here. I'm liable to be here all week in the parking lot, but we welcome everybody here, and thank you for coming, and those who are on the way. We praise God that He will bring them here safely, and we thank God for all those who are still coming and who are here. I'd like to have scripture and then prayer. And the scripture I've chose is out of Daniel. Daniel 12, verse 4. And it reads, "But you, Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book until the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased." I don't see my special, yes, I see my special music sitting in the cheap seats back there. And Stephanie, as always, is willing to share the talents that God has given her when she's asked. And I'm so grateful that she is here and is willing to share. So we'll go with her right now.
All right. While we're waiting for my son to tune the ukulele, let me just tell you a little bit about the background of the song. The song is called Kanaka Vai Vai. It is a Hawaiian hymn. It is about the story of the rich young ruler who went to ask Jesus, you know, he would like to follow him. What did he need to do? And he said to give away everything. So the first part is in English. And the second part is in Hawaiian. And Earl, please forgive me if I mess up anything. But the part that is in Hawaiian says, give away your riches and come follow me. And I'm being accompanied by my son today. And he wasn't put in the bulletin, but this is Xander. He'll be entering seventh grade this year. And my other son, it carried the chair. That's Leaf. All right. Let me walk through paradise with you, Lord. Take my hand and lead me there. All my earthly treasures I would gladly give. Teach me how to love and how to care. Greed and lust and vanity were mine, Lord. Then I found your love divine. Now on my knees I pray that I can find a way. Let me walk through paradise with you, Yahweh. Yahweh, he ha'abeli lo'iko
Thank you, Stephanie. Some of my favorite music, Hawaiian. I love it, the sound. My wife tells me I had a senior moment. I forgot to have prayer. And I asked the Lord's forgiveness. There were people coming in, and I didn't want to have prayer at that time. And then I looked around. I didn't see Stephanie. She's so short. I didn't see her in the back. So forgive me. Let's have prayer. Father, I know you forgive me. We're thankful, Father, for your blessings this Sabbath day, for allowing us to come out of the world today, to come to your house. Put blinders on us, Father, and help us to see only Jesus, for he's the one who's done it all for us. Help us, Lord, to be servants for you, to those who need. Please be with those who are on the way, Father. Be with us throughout this Sabbath day, these holy hours. Forgive us where we fail you. And now, Father, continue to be with us, we ask, in Jesus' name. Amen. I chose Daniel, that verse, especially because it says, knowledge shall be increased. Anybody living today has to know that knowledge is being increased. Men running to and fro. Coming back from vacation, I went on the computer to catch up on emails and what have you. And I have a very, very special website that I really enjoy. It's called Astronomy Pictures of the Day. Now, I've mentioned this before, but anyway, each day there's a new picture put out by the space team, and the archives go all the way back. You can go back years and pick out a picture and see it. And there has been some astonishing pictures. I like space. I like seeing these things people haven't seen in their life. Seeing pictures of the Mars rover, to actually see these pictures of rocks that has not moved in who knows when, since creation. Pictures of the landscape that up until now man has not seen. Only God has seen. But one picture blew me away. On the 22nd of July, the Cassini spacecraft was taking pictures. It has been sent to the planet Saturn to take pictures of Saturn and its moons. Fantastic pictures are coming back. This thing has just been taking all kind of pictures out there. Now, Saturn is the sixth planet from the sun. Saturn is the second largest planet. 755 Earths would fit inside of Saturn. The people who operate the Cassini spacecraft turn the camera back, and since the Lord is such orderly person, creator, everything is right on time. They turn that camera back to the vicinity where the Earth is supposed to be. That picture they took of the Earth and the moon. In that picture, you could see a little blue from the planet. That picture 900 million miles away. Think of it, brothers and sisters, 900 million. Who else? Well, before I say that, every human being, mankind, has been on that planet, has only been on that planet. Who else but our great Creator and our God has seen that image from 900 million miles away? Two dots in black space. Knowledge has surely been increased. We are so tiny, we are not even worthy, but yet Jesus Christ came to save us. I was blown away. And if anybody is interested in looking at that, go to that website and you'll be just thrilled almost every day of what you see. Living in our time, there's a lot of negativism, isn't it? But there's some positives in it too. Now, I asked Robinson if he would give us a mission story and on what happened at the fair. I was gone at the lot of the time of the fair. I never got to the fair this year. So I'm looking forward to hearing what he has to share with us about what all went on and the witnessing program that Chula Vista has done at the fair. Robinson, thank you.
Good morning. Anybody visiting here today? Let me see your hands. Thank you so much. Thank you for coming and joining us in our Sabbath school today. Just to give a little note that we had a health ministry booth at the Del Mar Fair this year. We started last year and we continued it this year. And Del Mar Fair is a big deal. This year, 1,492,200 people went to the fair. And on July 4th alone, 97,300 people went to the fair. Most people, when you think about going to the fair, you know why they go there? They go for junk food. They go for fun. And then we are in this corner telling them, don't eat that stuff. It's not good for you. So it's a little tough thing to do, and I'm not the best person to do this, because Efren and Cindy are the main people, that they're the glue that runs it. So I'm going to have him come in at the end and give a report on how many people we met and other things. But my wife always says, you talk a lot. So I don't want to talk a lot today. And what I've done is I've asked 2-3 other people to come and give us a report on what they felt in the fair. How many of you were at the fair helping? Let me see, everybody who went to the fair to help. There were so many people, you know, there were more than 50 of our members and other members came to help us. And I'm sure we would want to continue next year. And please prepare to come help us. And the first person is, I asked Loida and Randall to give us their idea of what happened at the fair. And when I called Loida, she was very gracious in accepting. And she said, my husband will do it. So Loida, I hope Randall is here. Okay, Randall. And we also have Edna. And Auntie Mercy, I don't see her. Ah, there. Go
ahead. I didn't get the whole story from Loida. And I don't remember a whole lot about what went on that day. But I do remember at the end of the day, we were there on Sabbath, and we had a potluck. Robinson's family brought some good food, and all the other people that were working there brought some good food. And after we closed, the Robinson and Efren have invited all the other fair employees from the nonprofit area where we were working. And so that gave us a chance to witness to other employees and some of the people from the other booths that were in our area. And that's the good thing I remember from that day. Also, there was a, it was the same weekend they were having a beer festival. And a drunk guy threw up in front of our booth. That's my negative memory of that day. But I just got a new book this summer. It's called The God-Shaped Brain by an Adventist psychiatrist, Dr. Tim Jennings. And I thought I'd read a little bit from that. It's about serving others, which is what we were doing there that day, that month. Dozens of studies over several decades have examined relationships between volunteer work and health-related outcomes. Most studies have shown positive volunteering health associations. Among youth, evidence suggests that volunteer work is associated with a plethora of positive developmental outcomes, such as academic achievement, civic responsibility, and life skills that include leadership and interpersonal self-confidence. And the author also talks about how God designed our brains to where when we make good, loving decisions, it actually wires itself differently from when we make hateful decisions or fear-based decisions. So I would recommend this to everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you for your invitation, Robinson.
Thank you very much. Edna, please come up. When I called Edna, she says, "I don't speak in front of people." And I said, "Do you remember Moses? He said the same thing." Yes, Edna Elgado.
Is it okay if you just smile because I'm nervous? I'm just going to smile a little while. I'm a little nervous, but going to the volunteering to the Del Mar Fair was a real blessing to me. I learned a lot of things. I was inspired. I met all the other volunteers who went there to give their talents and their time. And Auntie Cindy always says, you know, going to the Del Mar Fair is like going on a mission trip. And I said, yes, it's for me, it's going on a fishing trip.
Yes.
Jesus is the main fisherman, and we are his co-fishermen. And we fish for souls. So that was my experience at the Del Mar Fair. A lot of things, and God gives us gifts and talents that he is going to use. He wants to reach out. My feeling was Jesus wanted to reach out to as many people as he could at the Del Mar Fair through us. And using every little bit of talent. So maybe my talent is just saying hi and smiling. And that's all. And another thing is, oh, you know, when people get their blood pressure taken and they are brought to us, those who are willing to, who volunteer to do the Carrada scale, and when they give that, what do you call that?
The reading sheet,
and they're going to give it to those people doing the Carrada scale, and they'll say, hi, Edna, this is, you know, so-and-so, and she's going to take care of you, and this is, you know, Grace, and that becomes personal to me, because then I'm able to relate to that person. And then when you, after you do the Carrada scale, and you record all of the information that he has, and you pass it on to the consultants, to the counselors,
yeah.
And that's another thing. It's such a blessing to listen to the counselors give their advice to the people who went there. And people are so willing and interested to listen to what is going on with their bodies. And so, and the last step, when they talk about the new start, and at the end, they talk about trusting in God, which is the T of the new start. And then it's so inspiring to listen to observe them listening very carefully about trusting God after everything, after talking about the water and, you know, the sunlight, need for exercise and need for rest. But at the end, it always ends up with saying, trusting in God. So then they, for me, like I have always been there when Auntie Mercy was there, and he gives this advice to couples, to whole families, and it's wonderful. It's like listening to a real a live counseling session. And they talk about, you know, families and husbands and wives and how they can be close to God and how they can have their keep their bodies healthy and preparing their bodies for the coming kingdom. And another thing that really impressed me, that made an impression in me was, so Pastor Alex, the one who made the, is there no picture of the?
No.
There is, Pastor Alex every day does a painting. We call it the mural. And the picture itself, the painting itself, really speaks by its own self. And a lot of people come to the booth and they say, that's awesome, that's a beautiful painting. And it's a way, it's always a starting point of discussion. And especially, Pastor Alex has a special touch on ministering to children. Because when kids pass by and they say, wow, that's beautiful. And Pastor Alex, even when he's painting, he goes down and really takes time to explain to the children, do you know who that is? Do you know who that person is? What is the picture about? And when they say, it's just, sometimes I say, a lot of people don't know about Jesus. But kids, when they look at the picture and they say, I think that's God. And so Pastor Alex says, okay, I'm going to give you, because you answered right, I'm going to give you a book. So that's the way he shares the great controversy. And another thing that I was, as a volunteer, that we did was prepare these goodie bags, which contain the great controversy and other wonderful materials about health, about Jesus coming, about the glow tracks. And I just pray that people who got them would really read what they had received. And also on the last day, July 4th, there were so many people, and the booth was so packed, and people were waiting outside for their turn, and there was very, very little space for us to go around the booth. And I said, I think I said this to Robinson, I said, is it always like this at the end of the fair? And he said, yes. Maybe what I was meaning to say is, is it going to be like this at the end? At the end of time when Jesus will come and people will just be lining up and just wait and so excited to learn about the Word of God. And then he said, yes, it's going to be like this. So that is my experience of the Del Mar Fair. And a lot of people were blessed. People around the booths, in the booths that were our neighbors, they were every day they could see the painting grow bigger and bigger and more wonderful. And I was so blessed by that experience. So thank you.
Can you say amen to her? She's not afraid. Two things. Counselors, when we talk about counselors, you know, our counselors, some of them were young people, Justin and Earl, were our counselors. They would counsel all these people who come around, you know. It's an awesome experience. It's so wonderful. And Pastor Alex, and I'm going to let him tell his story. You're such a blessing to us. In two, three more weeks, he's going to come up and he's going to tell us his story. And Auntie Mercy, please come up.
Good morning. Good morning. Del Mar Fair was a unique outreach ministry. And at the same time, it was very rewarding. Our mission was to spread the gospel through the health message. Yes. And God has surely blessed us because he brought more than 1,000 people to our booth. These people came from New York, Ohio, Oregon, Washington, Arizona, New Orleans, Missouri, Virginia, all over the United States. And there were many tourists that came. They came from Hawaii, Guam, Taiwan, the Philippines, China, Burundi, East Africa, South Africa, Guyana, India, Pakistan, Iran, Italy, Israel, Indonesia, Malaysia, Singapore, Korea, Brazil, Peru, Mexico, and Canada. There were some more that came, but when we got so busy, I missed asking where they came from. Now, each one of them came excited and also anxious to find out what the results of the body analysis was. After the blood pressure was taken, and then their body mass index, visceral fat, body weight, and the body age was written and given to the counselors, like Earl, me, Justin, Auntie Luella, and many others. Then we have to let them face the results. And many of them, right there and then, decide to make some changes in their lifestyle. That's the time we present the New Start program. And they are very willing to do some changes. And I bring in 3 John 2. I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. And also letting them know that our bodies are not ours. It is God's temple. And we are accountable to what we do with it. And when they made the decision, I ask, would you be willing for us to ask God's blessing, your decision? And they are more than willing. They never rejected prayer. So I pulled Pastor Alex Riano from his painting and let him pray with us. They live blessed and so thankful. I have 2 instances that I was so impressed with because of the lack of time. There was this 93 gentleman that came after walking 2 hours. He was walking erect. He was mentally oriented to person, place, and to his surroundings. And he was not exhausted at all. He was all smiles. He was using eyeglasses. He said, it's just for reading. And at the same time, it becomes an eyeglass when it is exposed to the sun. And he has no hearing aid. He has been married 65 years to his wife, who he calls my sweetie. The next day, a 93-year-old also came. He has also been walking. He has no eyeglasses. He has no hearing aid. He reads very well. With him, he brought a stack of lab results since 1980 to the present. And he wanted me to explain these results to him. I looked at it, and I was so surprised. Most of them are within the normal range. There was one he was so concerned about, blood pressure 101, 101, and it's just 1 point above the normal. And a liver function test that is just above normal, just 1 or 2 points. I assured him, you know, everything is okay. What I ask with these to these gentlemen is, can you please share with me what you have been doing, why you are in good health? Because it was time for me to shut up. They have been practicing New Start all these decades. And so they said, during our late 30s, early 40s, we found out that we were not living a healthy lifestyle. So we quit smoking, we stopped drinking alcoholic beverages, coffee, and even soda. We exercise every day. We eat the heavy kind of bread that's full of nutrition. What I mean, they said, is the whole wheat full of nuts, grains, and also some seeds in it. And we have our own garden. We walk every day. And we decided to go to church once a week. And also made sure that we sleep well and drink lots of water. And then I asked, and how about God? He said, God has blessed us. That's why we are healthy. We are strong. I read without eyeglasses. Said one, both of us don't have hearing aid. We listen to our pastor. And we trust God every day. And we hope to live more than 100. To show to everyone that you can live a healthy life. And at the same time, praise God. When I ask, is it all right for us to bless you with prayer? Said, oh, please do, because we trust God. And again, I pull Pastor Alex to come and pray with them. And they leave. And thanking us and said that we bless them. Actually, to me, I was very blessed. This Delmar Fair outreach has blessed me. It was a very rewarding experience to me and everyone that had taken part. We gave our time and our lives to the Lord during this day. We were also blessed. And the work is not finished. It is not done. It will move on. Many of them would like to have Bible studies and for us to pray with them. So I'm asking you to please pray for this that came to our booth. There's a reason why God sent them. They would like to come attend the cooking class of Earl. And at the same time, come and visit our church. So it's my prayer that each one of us, when we see them coming, we don't know, they may be strangers. They might have come from that place. They want to attend church with us. And please, let's open our arms, open them wide with, you know, a warm handshake, a friendly smile, and even invite them to sit with us. God bless us. Thank you.
Thank you, Auntie Mercy. Uncle Efren, come on up. I know it's late. Give us 5 minutes because he needs to give us an idea of what happened. And I thank God for these missions. It's been awesome, wonderful.
Good morning and happy Sabbath to you all.
Good morning.
Just want to thank all of the volunteers. It's been, you know, without you, it's not going to happen. As you can see, it needs manpower. At the end, I'm sorry I didn't give you, I just didn't have enough time this week. Didn't give you the things that happened in the last. The last Sunday, oh, no, it wasn't Sunday. What was it, July 4th?
July 4th. It's
Thursday. The last day, I was just so happy that most of the volunteer came. Although I told them at the very beginning, if your name is not in the schedule, please don't come. We don't want too many people. Because that last day, we had attended 132 people. Just think of that. How would you handle 130 people? So I'm just glad that all of the counselors were there. Even Alex was counseling. Outside, you know, there was no room. We only have allowed three tables for counseling. But anyhow, it was so great. We didn't break the record of last year. Last year, I think over 1.5 million. This year was 1.4, you said?
Yeah.
So for the past 5 years, actually, they've been breaking record, except this year. It went down 10,000 something. But just think of that. A lot of people. Of course, like Robinson was saying, they come there for food or new things. But we came there for one purpose, and that is to look for souls who God had prepared for us. So this year, we had a total of 1,206 that came to our booth. Amen. 1,206 in 24 days. So basically, we average, 50 a day between 11 to 6. It's a lot of work, but you know what? Working for the Lord is not really work. It's an honor. Amen. And it's a privilege. So don't look at it as, you know, it's a work. Oh, I don't have time. God give you 24 hours a day. He only asks for minute of your time. But I tell you, when you help people, it's you that's being helped spiritually, actually. You've been blessed. And I've been blessed. So out of that 1,200, we have 470 that are interested in our help missions. And out of that 400, we had, I can't remember how many that want seminars, Bible seminars. And out of that, we have 57 Bible studies. So I praise God for the 24 days that we were there. And I know to many, especially to my wife, because I go to work, I get up here, I go to work, and I only relieve her in the afternoon. But I just want to praise God for, you know, a loving wife who loves the Lord, and she just wants to do what she can do for the Lord. You know, many times we do something and we think, what can I get out of it? No. Heaven is our reward. You know, heaven is a given. You don't have to work for it. All you have to do is accept it, you see. But along as on our way towards heaven, let's take somebody with us. Would you pray for one person? One person to attend our coming seminar this coming September? Just pray for that one person. If it's one of us here, pray for that one person. Think, this room will be filled. Amen. Okay? So I just want to thank you so much. I was just given an envelope by Auntie Ann. It's from the state. What department? The agriculture? They are the one that sponsored this fair. And we have an investment. They give us $100 for being participation this year. So that goes back again to our next year's payment for our booth. So thank you so much. And if you don't have time, you know, make time. Always remember, you're special to God, and He knows the number of your hair. That's how special you are. So think, God, prepare me. Where can I serve you? Thank you.
Thank you very much. By God's grace, we will again do it next year. Please come help us, and may God bless our church, that our church will grow and grow and grow. This is our prayer. Sorry to take this long.
Don't be sorry, a message is a message. Thank you for all who participated. And I'll tell you that Pastor Alex will be here the last Sabbath of the month with the program. So would the teachers please stand? We're about to break for our classes, and those who I can wait up here if you need it to know where to go, where the classes are. Or you can see whoever's standing there, all teachers can lead you there as well. Let's have prayer. Father, thank you again for blessing us this morning, for the message that we heard, for the witnessing that was done. It's all for your honor, Father, and your glory. Please be with those who are still coming. Help us, Father, to get out of your lesson what you want each of us to have. We thank you again for your blessings and love. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
School lesson today. We don't know what kind of week you've had, but here's what we know. We know that whatever kind of week you had, that the Lord was able to have his hand in it. If it was tough, the Lord was still there. What we sometimes forget to do is invite him into our conflict, and we think we can go it alone. And we can't. because we're fighting against someone that has been studying human nature for thousands of years and know what we like, what we desire, and he knows that we don't desire to follow God's will. So he provides things, he suggests things, and when we don't trust the Lord, then we end up in big, big trouble. This week I was going to an appointment at the DMV, and I had my GPS on. And have your GPS ever give you wrong information?
Oh, let me tell you. My wife.
Could you clarify? Because I'm not sure.
Yeah, well, she tells me that. Now, mind you, I just bought her a new one, okay? I didn't know this story before, but anyway, the GPS she had before was terrible. You couldn't understand it most of the time. But anyway, here's the deal. It told her to go a certain way. She's a hospice nurse. So, you know, she often is going to places she's never been. And so it took her on this road and so forth. And it turns into a little dirt road. And it goes right up to a cliff.
Wow.
And it was telling her to go over the cliff.
Aye.
Yeah, that's my story.
Yeah.
It's actually her story, but...
That's not a good one.
No.
My GPS was leading me to Mexico. I saw a sign that says, last U.S. exit. And I made a U-turn. You know, so...
Oh.
Anyway, again, we're glad to have you. We're going to begin our study. We're going to have prayer real quick.
Thank God that the Bible is not as unreliable as your GPS.
Or that one. Yes. And I have to say, my GPS has about a 98% accuracy. But is that 2% that you have to worry about?
Yeah. God's not that way.
No, 100% all the time. Any prayer requests?
Yes, Dave and Gail, I don't believe they're going to be with us today.
Okay.
Dave had an embolism.
Okay, Dave.
And we need to remember them in prayer today.
Definitely. Okay, what's her name? Suela? Suela, okay.
Okay. How do you say it again?
Suela.
Suela. That's G?
Z. Z.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
C-O-I-L-A.
All right. Yes. Joy, okay. I remember she was here a couple of weeks ago. Okay. Okay. Brother? Okay. Justin. All right. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful to be here in your sanctuary, and we thank you, Lord, for touching our minds and helping us to make the decision to be here today. We pray, Father, for Dave, for Zoila, for Joy, Margot, Justin, those who need your loving touch and your healing touch. But most of all, Lord, be with each of them and remind them in a special way that not only do you love them, but you have a special purpose for each of their lives. And that you will continue to work that purpose in each of them. We pray, Father, that you would be with them at the darkest time of the day and night. That they would remember your words that said you will never leave us nor forsake us. We pray, Father, for everyone who is sitting here today. Whatever situation or conflict they're facing, that, Lord, you would be with them through the storm and through the fire. We pray that your Holy Spirit would guide us now in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Amen.
For those of you who are visiting for the first time, I want to let you know we're not following the quarterly, but we have a study. We've been studying the seven trumpets of Revelation, and we've been studying it for a while. So we're almost finished with that. And then we're going to continue. Now, when we're done with that, we're going to look at the feast days, we're going to look at the investigative judgment, and we're going to look at some other things. So we hope you're able to stay with us. I see some new faces in the back. Could you guys tell us your name and where you're from? Hold on a second. We have people who are watching online, so we need to. We can hear you, but they can't. Okay. All right.
Hi. Hey, good morning, everyone.
Yes.
My name is Ron McCallicker. This is my wife, Tasha. This is our first time here. I'm originally from Pennsylvania, and she's from Rhode Island, but we're in the military, and we're out here in California now.
Okay, great.
So, thanks for having us.
Okay. You forgot somebody.
Hi, everyone. My name is Brenda Delgado, and I'm here with my mom. We're Seventh-day Adventists, but we usually go to the Spanish church.
ETA?
Yes.
Broadway?
ETA.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Gotcha. Thank you. Sir, do you mind telling us?
My name is Lance Feaster, and I haven't attended too many times here. I have attended many years with George Knowles when he had his class.
Okay, yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
How many years were you coming while Pastor Knowles was?
15.
Yeah, 15 years.
Okay. Okay, well, I wasn't here last week, so if you could bring us up to speed, Pastor.
Yeah, welcome back.
Yes.
Say. Welcome back.
I bring you greetings from the Ramona Church.
All right. Are you back to stay now?
I'm not sure I understand what that means.
All right. What we're studying right now is basically an outgrowth and a continuation and connected with the study that we just finished in the book of Revelation on the trumpets.
Okay.
That's where we saw this time of trouble at the end that's going to be brought on the earth, and it's going to be Satan that's doing all these things.
Yes.
Okay. Now we've come to this question: why is Jesus waiting to come? And you're going to get a handout if you haven't already got it. How many brought your handouts back? Uno, dos, tres. Three. Okay, well, maybe somebody better run back and tell Dave to make a whole lot more. I'm serious. Does somebody want to go tell Dave to make about twice as many as he was going to make? He's in a print room. So, anyway, why is Jesus waiting? How come he hasn't come back yet? Could he have come before now? Let's start with that. Could Jesus have come before now?
So we have a yes.
We have one yes.
One yes.
You're saying yes too?
Okay.
We have two yeses.
Gary?
Fred.
Fred, okay.
Fred, yeah.
Close. So let's start with why you say no. Fred?
His father hasn't told him to come back yet.
But why?
Because there's somebody that he's trying to wait to save.
Yes.
Okay.
Amen.
Okay. Charles, did you have something? Okay, if you could pass this on to Charles.
Maybe we should refine this, and I think you'll be sympathetic with this, to could Jesus have come before now?
Yes, Jesus could have come back. The Spirit of Prophecy says three times already. One was in the 1860s. Just after the 1844 disappointment. Another was in the 1890s. Christ could have come after the 1888 conference of righteousness by faith, but he did not. And Mrs. White said that we would have to live in this world for many more years before Jesus was going to come.
Because?
What's that?
And we were going
to ask. Because what happened in Israel, when they didn't go into the Promised Land, their failure was due to a lack of faith. And ours is exactly the same reason. We, the church and people, are not ready for Jesus because we have lack of faith to go into the Promised Land.
Yeah.
Okay. One of the reasons.
Mm-hmm. See, now there you have gone to the Bible, and that's what excites me when I hear, mm-hmm. aha, a biblical example of this. Yes. Mm-hmm. So now let's change the question to, could Israel have gone into Canaan the first time when they sent the 12 spies up there?
Yes.
How many say that they could have gone in? All right. Anybody say that it wasn't in God's plan or whatever? No, actually, it wasn't God's plan.
It wasn't God's plan, but they believed the 10 spies of failure of saying that they were giants in the land instead of the two that Caleb and Joshua, who said that they could take the land. So they went on the side of the wrong people.
Mm-hmm. And so we are in a similar situation where it is possible that Jesus could have come before now, and maybe we could even say that how soon he comes depends on us today preparing ourselves.
Yes.
Or let's put it this way, Jesus perhaps could come sooner than he will end up coming, and if he doesn't come, you know, soon, it may be because of us. So it's not that there's no lack in God's ability. It's a problem with us. Let's see, there was a comment. I thought somebody was raising their hand or whatever, about to speak.
Lupe?
We need the microphone there, yeah.
An example is like when you're having surgery. You can have the surgery room, the doctor's anesthesia, everything is ready, but you decide to have one sip of water. Everything goes down. You can't have it. Everything was ready, but I decided to do something that broke the plan.
Mm-hmm. Okay, put your hands up if you need, want, whatever. All this is, by the way, are the texts. You're not going to find the notes that I have here. My notes are not prepared enough to... There's too many misspellings and words. I don't know if you've noticed yet, but there's words in there that, you know, are extra anyway.
That's all right.
So it's not ready for public consumption yet. So... Okay, so yes, Jesus could have come before now. Now, we started off with this. In John, the first chapter of John, we have this verse, chapter 1, verse 10 and 11. I said verse, but actually verses, chapter 1, 10 and 11. He was in the world, and this is speaking of his first advent, and though the world was made by him, made through him, the world did not recognize him. Now, isn't that something? Here he makes us, and we don't recognize him. That's kind of curious. But here's the real point in the next verse. He came to that which was his own. Now, what is that talking about? He came to that which was his own. And his own did not receive him. That gives you a hint.
The Jews.
His own people. He came to his own people, and they did not what?
Receive
him. Well, I mean, after all, he came as a babe. He came as a human being. They weren't expecting this. I mean, how can you blame them, right? Oh, wait a minute.
Wait.
Can you blame them?
Yes, you can.
Well, yeah. Tell us why.
Because the prophecies told.
The prophecies told.
You know, they told where he was going to be born. They had an idea of when, because they had the 2300-day prophecy.
490-year prophecy.
Yes, and it told you, you know, so you look at the time frame. They knew.
Did they know where he was going to be born?
Yes.
Did they know where he was going to be born? Where was he supposed to be born?
Bethlehem.
Where he was born, okay?
Yes.
Was he born when he should have been born?
Yes.
Well, you know, they didn't know. We weren't given the year that he would be born, but we are given the year what? When he would be... What was the... Huh?
His ministry.
Yeah, the first... when he was anointed. See, a Messiah, the anointed one. They were told the year that he would be anointed to be the Messiah. And so you just can kind of, let's say that, let's see, okay. Let's say that we were to say, we know that, how does this work? Let me give me a second to think about this. Oh, look at it like this. Let's say that you ask somebody the age of their child, and their child is 40 years of age.
40?
40.
Okay.
Okay? You haven't asked them how old they are. Okay. You know, as a lady, you don't want to ask that question.
No,
okay,
not at all.
That? Do you remember that?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
But, you know, if you're sneaky, can you kind of figure out how old she is?
Yes.
How?
You add 20 on average.
That's right. Add 20. That's right. That's about the time. You know, it's just, you know, an average, not exact, but right. You can add 20, and you can tell about how old this person is,
yeah.
A man or woman, really, because that's about the age, round figures, when people have their children, right?
And see, guys aren't afraid to say how old they are.
Huh?
Guys aren't afraid to say how old they are.
But now, do you see what I'm getting at? You kind of know. And so if you kind of know when Jesus is going to be anointed, when the Messiah is going to appear, let's put it that way, can you kind of go back and figure out about when he would be born? If you knew that the Messiah was going to be born next year, if you knew that the Messiah was going to appear this year, let's say, could you maybe guess when about the time he would be born before that? Now, the Messiah is going to come as an adult.
Yes.
And they all expected an adult. Okay. So, how old do you think, how long, far back would he be in time? Would he be born then? Now, wait a minute. Why do you go for 30 and not my 20? There's a good reason for it.
Use the mic.
Hello. Wasn't it that before anyone was anointed to be king or to be anything, they had to be at least 30 years of age?
Yeah, you were considered to be mature at 30. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But you could go back. You could say, you know, subtract 20 from 2013 or subtract 30 from 2013 based upon that. And you kind of get a general idea when he would be appearing. And so my point is just this. All boils down to this. They should have known when he was going to come.
Yes.
They should have been expecting even about the time of his birth. All you have to do is go back, you know, between 20 or 15, let's say 15 to 40 years. And some time back in there, he would be born. Makes sense? Huh?
You exactly where to go. The city of Belen,
and they knew where to be watching.
Yeah. Exactly, and they knew he was going to be born of a virgin.
Mm-hmm.
So what would you do?
Well, you go to the town and you do a newspaper. You know, you go around. What's going on? What happened with Mary? Why was this rumors going around? Talk to them. If that was the case, but if God wanted him to be known as the Messiah. It really doesn't matter the time when he was born, you might think.
Yeah, that's
but
true.
We knew when he was going to be anointed.
But I just want to zero in on his birth, though.
Right.
Could they have known? What would you do if you wanted to make sure you didn't miss that event? What would you do?
Read the scriptures?
I think one of the things I would have done, because there was a census done.
Yeah.
So maybe check the records.
But now that's the census was done the year that Jesus was born.
Yeah.
So, I mean...
Yeah.
And was the census done the next year? Probably not.
Probably not.
So what would you do if you wanted to make sure you didn't want to miss an event, but you weren't sure, you know, you had a range of years, what would you do? Let's just use your sanctified imagination.
We'll get you.
Let's have some fun here.
I would say you might want to pray and ask for inspiration from God.
Absolutely.
And someone said over here, I heard someone say, read, you know, study scripture.
Yeah.
I think God would speak to you through that. Mm-hmm. But what else could you do? Be vigilant. And how? Well, let's say, let's be vigilant here.
Well, reading scripture.
Okay.
Just be prepared for it.
All right. How do we be prepared? Let's, again, have fun. Just imagine that we're living back in those times.
Prayer.
Yeah. Get into my cross.
Well, I want to do something, and I would do something. I'll tell you, I would do something. I know what I'd do, but I want to hear what
you might
think. I
would definitely do this. For to do anything, for to understand the scriptures, or if you're going to do meditate or whatever, the first thing you will do is pray.
Amen. Okay. Pray, read scripture, stay in tune with God, because he's going to help you know. That's right. But what else could you do? You know, when it came to getting out of Egypt, what did they have to do? They had to go through the Red Sea. They didn't just stand there and say, well, let's pray and read scripture. Yeah, oh, sorry. They did something. How about when they finally went into the Promised Land and God said, all right, take the ark out in front of you. I mean, it's a famous story. We cite it all the time. All right? And so they're walking. And here's the water flowing. And what did they do?
They had to walk right into the...
They walked, so they did something. So what are we going to do to make sure we don't miss the birth of Jesus?
The scripture is clear. To trust and obey.
All right, I'm going to tell you what I would do.
Okay.
It's easy. I would make sure, let's say that I was the high priest or the king or whatever. I'd say, all right, I want someone stationed in Bethlehem starting right now. As far as we know, he hasn't been born yet. So let's send someone down there. And let's put it this way. I'd say the high priest from now on will see to it that Bethlehem has at least 10 of our representatives there keeping track of what's going on for the next 30, 40 years until he does arrive. And then when he arrives, we're going to have a big celebration. I mean, why not? Why not? Why did he have to be born in obscurity? My point is, he didn't have to be born in obscurity. The only reason he was born in obscurity was because God's people were not praying. They were not reading God's word. And they weren't watching. They weren't, you know, vigilant to watch what was going on in Bethlehem. Why else did God tell them where he'd be born? But so that they could be ready. Well, but see, the high priest didn't have to be a pagan.
I mean,
but God's people,
kings were watchful, and they came looking for him. And his own people were...
Oh, those kings. You're talking about the kings of the East.
Yeah.
Yes. See, there you go. God had to send angels to some shepherds on the hillside. Otherwise, nobody would have been there the night he was born. And God moved upon kings from other countries to come and pay him homage.
Mm-hmm.
Could he have moved on upon his own people? Yes, he could. And see, that's really where we need now to shift to the question of, could we be ready for Jesus to come again? And if we can, what is this going to look like? When Jesus came the first time, there was he got no notoriety. His church was a mess. They didn't glorify him at all. But we read in, let's go back to our paper here. We read in 2 Thessalonians, please look down the page. It's right there on the handout. You who are troubled, rest with us when the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven. That's his second coming,
mm-hmm.
with his mighty angels. When he shall come to be what? Glorified in his saints. In other words, he came in obscurity the first time, but he's not coming in obscurity the second time.
Amen.
He came and his church was not ready the first time, but they will be ready the second time.
Amen. Amen.
Let's look at some more scripture along that line of what shape his church will be in. The next passage, Christ loved the church, gave himself for it, that he might sanctify it, cleanse it with the washing of the water of the word, that he might present it to himself, a glorious church at his second coming, a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. That's the kind of church he's coming back for. After these things, I saw four angels standing in the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth. Let's just skip down because of time toward the end of that passage. And it says, tells them to not hurt the earth or the sea or the trees till we have what?
Sealed.
Sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. Reading on, Isaiah 8:16. Bind up the testimony, seal the law amongst my disciples. Okay? The law, of course, is the character of God. Reading on, Ephesians 1:13. In whom you also trusted that after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after you believed, you were sealed with what?
The Holy Spirit.
Does that, now is the Holy Spirit being sealed with the Holy Spirit and sealed with the law two different things? No, because what does the Holy Spirit minister to us? What does he work into us but the character of Christ? And the character of Christ is found in the obedience
to
the will of God, which is seen in his word. Mm-hmm. So if you seal with the law and you're sealed with the Holy Spirit, it's the same thing. Ephesians, down to Ephesians 4:30. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed unto the day of redemption. Romans 8:4. That the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. See, it is possible for the righteousness of the law to be fulfilled in us if we are sealed, or if we are under the influence, or if we are filled with, controlled by, walking according to what? The Holy Spirit. Okay? This is the covenant I'll make in the house of Israel at that time, declares the Lord. I'll put my laws in their minds and write them in their hearts. I will be their God and they will be my people. You know what's interesting about that passage? If you look at Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 to 4, you'll see that God says the holy city comes down and God is with them and he will be there. He will be their God and be their people. So this is like a reference to the time after the second coming. Okay? Not that this will happen at that time, but this is right there at the end is what I'm saying. God's people will have his character written in the character of Christ written in their minds and their hearts. And then look at the last passage there, Ephesians 4:11. He gave some apostles and prophets and some evangelists and pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying, that's the building up of the body of Christ. 13, till we all come in the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. When God's church is filled with God's Spirit and he has written his law in our hearts, then the church will be what Paul is describing here, a perfect man. The perfect man is Jesus, okay? We become like this perfect Jesus. And it's all in the last days, so that when Christ comes again, he will be glorified in his church. He will not come unnoticed. We will be ready. We will be ready.
Amen. And I think that what Edna was talking about at the fair with all those people at the last day, I think we're going to see that.
Uh-huh.
You know, when his church is ready, Amen. People will gravitate to that.
There are lots of people who are not Seventh-day Adventists that put Seventh-day Adventists to shame.
Yes.
In terms of the depth of their spiritual experience, mm-hmm. their love of God, their willingness to serve him, be active for, you know, in his cause. Man. They're good people in the other churches. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Now let your neighbors know that, you know. We Seventh-day Adventists don't look at other Christians as if they're inferior to us. Now we have a message. We've been tasked with a special task. But that doesn't make us better. That just makes us more responsible.
Amen.
Well,
we're out of time.
We're past that, actually. We welcome you here today.
Did you have a question?
Hope that you've been blessed. Listen, I'll tell you what, we're going to have to wait. If you have questions, let's have prayer, and then you can ask your questions privately, okay? Because we need to get on and start getting ready for the next service.
Yeah.
So who's going to pray for us?
David.
All right, David.
Dear Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for this message. We thank you for all your messages that you provide us and lead us, dear God, to be not just hearers of the word, but doers of the word also.
Amen.
Give us strength to witness to those who are in darkness or to those who do not know your true word, and help us to minister to those in a loving way, Lord. Mm-hmm. Help us also, I pray for a blessing today, and as we come to you in your Sabbath day to worship and honor you, Lord. I pray for those who are still on the road coming, that they may be have safe traveling mercies, and that they may arrive safely, and that we may have the blessing of your message and in your service today. Mm. We pray for all these things in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.